Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Zack Ford is standing by. He writes for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. You've really been on top of all the stories that are spooking me and my listeners this week, so I want to get right to it. How are you, sir?
I'm pretty spooked, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, I had a day off on Tuesday to make up for having worked over the weekend, and I actually had a really great day of self-care. And I had this like one little moment. I thought about some of the conversations I've had with you. I had just gone to see a matinee of Avengers Endgame because it was a little late to that party, and it was a beautiful day, like blue skies, but like some kind of clouds, like the light breezy air. And I was walking down the street from the movie theater to where I was about to get a pedicure, and for like just a few minutes, I remembered what it felt like to be relaxed, to like not think about work drama or family drama or political drama or romance drama or just anything. I was just like, I just feel lovely right now, and I'm not thinking about anything. And I went and had a pedicure, and it was relaxing and lovely. And then I like made the mistake of looking at my phone again, and there was a school shooting and Trump's taxes, and it was just like it all kind of came crashing back. But for like that one glimmer, I had like a little bit of self-care. So do something for yourselves out there, folks. Like, just do one little thing where you don't think about all the other stress in the world, because it's worth it.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%, because this is all man-made. And
all of it.
And we're supposed to be scared. If we're afraid, we can be talked into anything, i.e., right after 9/11, we invaded the wrong country. So we have to watch yourself. And I'm suspicious even of calling this a constitutional crisis. It's a political crisis. We have a Republican Party that has been hijacked by a mobster. We have a mobster in the Oval Office, and he works through coercion, through compromise. He gets people to do and say things out of fear. And you gotta just accept that there is a mobster in the Oval Office, and the people who are speaking for him and doing his bidding are dirty. There's something on them. And, you know, we're all dirty. There's stuff I don't want people to know about me. And if somebody came to me and said, if you don't stop attacking the president, we're going to, you know, tell the world about your shoplifting when you were 2 years old, something like that. We all have something we want hidden. I'm not famous or powerful enough to be blackmailed, but when you get into the richest 1% or when you get power in Washington, there's stuff on you that you don't want released, and he's got it, and he's a mobster. It's not a constitutional crisis, I don't think. Okay.
Well, can it be both and, though? Like, yeah, he's a mobster and acts that way. And it is also a constitutional crisis because we have one branch of the government not respecting the authority of the other branch. And so the whole premise of three co-equal branches of government that check and balance each other is not currently in play, and is very much teetering on the brink of falling apart in favor of an imperial presidency. So it might be because there's a mobster who's functioning in this way, but I think it still holds true that our Constitution is very much in danger. You in danger, girl. You in danger.
I agree with you, and it's spooky, but you got to step back and realize we've been here before, and the Constitution is my religion. I believe you can find the answer to all our difficulties through the Constitution. That being said,
I disagree. I think it was like a great idea for its time, but I think we figured out a whole lot of stuff that's been better since then, and I'm not married to it that way. Ooh, no, I'm gonna have to push back on that one a little bit.
Well, there you go. And so the constitutional crisis doesn't register with me, and people shouldn't be that terrified because you make compromises like Joe Biden. You know, it suits the Democratic Party very well if we're in a constitutional crisis, because then everything gets put on the back burner and we have to focus on evil Trump. That being said, I loathe this guy. My heart is beating. I mean, he's going to give me a heart attack, some of the stuff that I've seen.
Go get a pedicure. This is one of the biggest things I'm happy to encourage straight men out there to do, because they never think about it and they're like weirded out by it. Go get a pedicure. It's the most relaxing like half hour of your life, and it'll ease you a little bit back off that heart attack.
Okay. My ex-wife's best friend did mani-pedis, and I was supposed to go for one. What is a pedicure?
Oh, they clip your toenails and pumice your feet, and you know they apply like nice lotions like all the way up your lower leg, and you're sitting in a massage chair at the same time, so you're getting treatment on other parts of your body. It's just very relaxing, and you know, you clean up a part of your body that you probably don't focus as much on.
Okay.
Totally. 100% recommend. I've taken straight friends and they're like, really? And I'm like, yeah. And they're like, oh, I get it now.
Mm-hmm. All right. There is a lot to go over, and you've done such an incredible job over at Think Progress writing about all the things that are scaring me and what I care about. Let's start with Kamala Harris, who is running for president. She's the former Attorney General of California. And when Bill Barr was testifying, she grilled him in such a way that my heart, I got, like, I don't know, I can't even describe. How did you, just before we get to the story and your article about the Inspector General investigating the Justice Department, just on a visceral level, the exchange between Kamala Harris and Bill Barr, what did that do to you?
You know, I find it so vindicating when you know someone's a bad guy, when you know that at in the most generous fashion, he's at least being misleading. But we also know that he sort of outright lied about some things. When somebody can get in there and grill him in such a way that he can't escape, he can't come up with a form of spin to justify that, you know, you're on to something. You know that there's a vulnerability there. And I think Harris really honed in on that and isn't backing off. And so I think that in all of these discussions where you have Trump constantly defending Barr and Republicans, you know, coming up with all kinds of spin for why, you know, how to justify his actions, Harris is really honing in on, here's a clear example of something that you did not do right and you can't, you know, make up an excuse for.
It was an Aaron Sorkin moment. The problem is there's so many Aaron Sorkin moments in this presidency, they have no currency. But the exchange between Kamala Harris and Bill Barr was breathtaking. Tell what happened, what she asked him and what he tried to do and didn't get away with.
Sure. So the specific question that she wanted to know was, has Trump or anyone else at the White House ever asked him or suggested of him that he open an investigation of anyone? And this is really important because we know Trump talks all of the time about how he thinks, oh, we got to investigate Hillary. You know, he gave a rally Wednesday night and his supporters still chant lock her up about Hillary. It's 2019.
And now
there's all this talk this week about Biden, this story that Giuliani manufactured that was debunked, you know, 36 hours after the New York Times accidentally, you know, took him seriously. So we know that there's this motivation among the president to use the legal force of his office to target his opponents. And Harris wanted to know, you know, Barr's only been there a couple months. Has this happened? Because there's clear indications in the Mueller report of Trump doing this kind of thing. And Barr could not give a yes or no. And in fact, he even admitted that there had been, quote, discussions, but he wasn't sure if he could go so far as to say that it had been suggested of him to undertake one of these investigations. And Harris kept pressing him, you know, was it hinted at? Was it inferred? And eventually he just said, I don't know, which is not the answer that we want, right? We want him to honestly and concisely be able to say no the president did not ask me to abuse this office to investigate his opponent. And he could not say that. And the other thing that I think is important to keep in mind is when Michael Cohen testified a few months ago, one of the things that he was really focused on sharing with us is that Trump speaks in code, right? He communicates in this way where if you have his trust, you understand what he's asking of you. Mm-hmm. Without him spelling it out. And so it was really important that, it was that Harris was parsing all of this tentative language about suggestions or inferences or things like that, because that's the way Trump tells people to do things for him.
Right. Like saying to Jim Comey, I need your loyalty.
Mm-hmm.
So is it against the law for a president to investigate his political opponents?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, it is.
Uh-huh. And is he complaining that Russiagate is an example of Obama investigating political opponents?
Well, of course, we have all of these claims that, he was spied on or things like that, right? He really wants to grill. He keeps saying, oh, we haven't told the full story yet. And, there are these other Clinton Ukraine connections or other things like that that he still wants to figure out, like really not shying away from having this motivation. It's just a question of whether or not he's actually had that kind of conversation with Barr, and it really sounds like he has.
What is an inspector general, and why did Kamala Harris request the Justice Department's inspector general to look into whether or not President Trump ordered Bill Barr to investigate his enemies?
So the Justice Department and the Attorney General specifically is basically the lawyer for the country, and it's the check on whether everything else is functioning legally properly, at least in theory. And the Inspector General is the person inside the Department of Justice that makes sure that the Department of Justice is running according to the law. And so what Harris did is reach out to the Inspector General and say, hey, she said, this is an alarming response that strikes at the very heart of the rule of law and threatens to undermine the longstanding independence of the Justice Department. You need to look into this and do your own internal investigation to make sure that the head of your department is not, heeding these kinds of requests that totally violate the law.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, do we know whether or not the Inspector General is going to look into the Justice Department? There's an Inspector General for every federal department.
Correct. And I have not yet heard of any reports confirming a response to the letter. But it's clear that Harris is going to continue to press this one way or the other. So if she doesn't hear it, I suspect she will take additional actions to either call for, an oversight response from the Senate or some other kind of action.
Right. And a little piece of trivia, there are 73 federal offices of inspector generals, and each one is assigned to a specific agency or department, and that is a post-Watergate piece of legislation, the Inspector General Act of 1978. Hunter...
And I would just point out, it's inspectors general.
Oh, okay.
Just like it's attorneys general.
Oh, okay. Hunter Biden, I was convinced that it was another example of Biden's corruption. So you're saying Hunter Biden isn't guilty of trying to influence Joe Biden's pressure on the Ukrainian prosecutor to have the Ukrainian prosecutor fired?
No, my understanding is that it came out shortly thereafter that he wasn't even on that board until after all of that happened. So to draw any connection between the two is fake news.
Hmm. And the New York Times fell for it.
Yes. Well, because, I've had this conversation with a number of other reporters this week. There's this thing that happens where if you want access, you have to kind of do some favors sometimes. And the New York Times wants access to Giuliani. And it's telling that in the reporting that was sort of pointing this finger at Biden, they acknowledged that it was all coming from Giuliani, but they wrote it anyway. And so it's one of these things where, there are a lot of great questions posed by it, but they should have answered them before they published the story, and they didn't, and that's problematic. So, you know, it's a question of how far are you willing to go to appease the people that you want to continue to, you know, give you comments and give you information. And in this case, that relationship resulted in an article that reached the wrong conclusion.
Well, part of the constitutional crisis is that Donald Trump won't release his tax returns, even though Congressman Neal, who chairs the House Ways and Means Committee, has subpoenaed them. Steve Mnuchin, I don't know if he's been held in contempt yet, but he's the Treasury Secretary. He's refusing to turn over the tax returns, even though a law specifically says the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee can request the president's tax returns, and if the Secretary of the Treasury doesn't turn them over, he goes to prison. But that's one part of the puzzle. The New York Times got their hands on some tax returns of the presidents from, I guess, the mid-80s to the mid-90s and published their findings. When I read your piece and when I read the New York Times article about the president's taxes, I realize something else is going on here. I keep racking my brain trying to figure out how we got to this place in American history. And reading your piece and the New York Times, we have a genuine mobster in the White House, or somebody who's being propped up by a genuine mobster has propped this man up for decades and put him in the Oval Office. He's not a Putin asset. He is some mobster has been protecting him and treating him as a useful idiot. That's why he gets away with everything. Tell us what's in, that's my conclusion.
It's an interesting hypothesis. It's not one that's mutually exclusive from him being a Putin puppet though either. So there are, in fact, Russian mobsters, and we could be talking about the same thing.
Yeah, I find it curious on two parts. He is owned by somebody. If you read Wayne Barrett, if you read David K. Johnston, they've been covering Donald Trump since the late 70s. They have pretty much spelled out that Donald Trump is owned by the New York Mafia, someone in the New York Mafia. Roy Cohn was the Mafia's lawyer. When he keeps saying, I need my Roy Cohn, Roy Cohn introduced him to the Gambino family. You cannot build in New York unless you're Mafia. Donald Trump, and I think it's time we started saying this, and we have a mobster in the Oval Office who is owned by somebody in the underworld. It is as clear as a crystal.
That very well could be. You know, I think the thing about this whole story that's most disturbing to me is the idea that he believes he should be celebrated, not necessarily because of what he still claims turned out okay for him in the end. You know, we only saw up to like 1995 or something, and he believes, you know, he won it all back, and so all these massive financial losses don't count for anything. Although like 10 years of like financial loss is a whole lot of time of financial loss. Like I'm 33 right now, and if I were losing money every year for the past 10 years, let alone, you know, in the millions of dollars totaling over $1.1 billion, like, my life would not be okay, right?
Yeah. And he has to have a sugar daddy.
Well, and he literally did, because his own father propped up his losses. But the other piece of it here is not just that, like, he got through it and somehow still persevered, but the idea that in a way, he should be praised for getting away with it, right? Like, you know, he talked in his little tweet after the story came out that this was sport. And, you know, you just renegotiate with the bank. And it's not sport, because as I tried to, you know, point to in my piece, like, when casinos go out of business, a whole lot of people lose their jobs. Mm-hmm. You know, when banks lose a whole lot of money, there are other people at that bank who suffer, not just the bank. You know, like, it's, you're playing with other people's money, and you don't care whether you win or lose. Other people are losing. Right. And Trump actually believes that because he was able to convince the banks to keep taking risks on him and letting him play with other people's money, that alone is a win, right? That, like, he's playing this quote unquote sport and he is effectively gaming it. And so it's almost like he wants credit for being villainous just because of the fact that he got away with it and everybody still loves him. It's this weird tautological, I was terrible, but you loved me, so you should love me because I was terrible, and then you loved me anyway, right? It's bizarre, but it's warped. It's really warped.
Didn't he lose more money several years than any other American who pays taxes?
That's what the Times reported.
I mean, think about that for a second. The President of the United States has set, like, the Guinness World Book of Record for most losses in a year. It's astounding. And then he has $57 million in dividends that can't be explained 1 year.
Right. There's these weird windfalls along the way too that just stand out as clear anomalies, and with the records we currently have, we don't have good explanations for them.
Mm-hmm. When you show a loss, isn't that part of money laundering? It's an unfair question because you're not a money launderer, and I don't know anything about money laundering, but I do know that I've worked for comedy clubs that paid me in cash. I wasn't selling a lot of tickets. They didn't seem to mind. It was almost in their best interest not to show a profit, or it was inconsequential.
I'm not a financial or real estate expert, but my understanding, and this is something we kind of started to learn the first time that we got a little glimpse at some of Trump's financial records. Remember when Rachel Maddow spent like a half hour teasing us before she actually told us what she had, mm-hmm. Which is that people who own real estate can offer whatever arbitrary amount they want on their form in terms of how much they think their value has depreciated. And I don't think there's a lot of oversight in terms of whether or not the real estate actually depreciated that much. But if you show a loss in that amount, then you can write that off from your income tax. Mm-hmm. And so, like, the real significance here is that he was losing lots of money, but he was making lots of money. But because he lost more and then could, like, also use this depreciation tactic, got away with not paying income tax for 8 of those 10 years.
Elijah Cummings, who's the chairman of the House Oversight Committee, when Michael Cohen was testifying, he said exactly what you just said. He said that when Trump is filling out his tax forms, he devalues the property. But when he's looking for a loan to borrow against that property, he lies about what it's worth. So he's lying to the federal government on his taxes, and he's lying to the bank stupid enough to lend him money. And Elijah Cummings is subpoenaing his accountant's records, and Donald Trump has filed suit against his own accountants not to turn his documents over to House Oversight. Yeah, it's pretty bad. And he knows exactly what he's doing. I think the narrative, and I want to ask you about the White House press corps in a second. The New York Times does a great job covering this president. They do. They've been on him since day one, and as of you've been on top, and Think Progress has been on top of him. The White House press office revoked credentials this week. Tell us what happened, and then I want to ask you what you think the press should be doing with Donald Trump when it comes to reporting his every move, his every utterance.
Sure. So as far as we know, there's only been one credential that we certainly know happened, and that was Washington Post columnist Dana Milbank, because on Wednesday, Milbank wrote a column about how after having a White House hard pass for 21 years, his credential was taken away. And this is part of a new policy that was actually introduced in March. So we did know that it was coming. It's not a total surprise, but it's still that visceral reality of it's actually happening, and this is what it looks like. And so the policy is that if you want to maintain your White House hard pass as a journalist, this is a 2-year pass that lets you easily come into the building every day without having to wait in line and go through all the double checks of your, social security number and photo IDs and all that stuff. It's just we know you, come on in. You, over the past 180 days, and we're talking calendar days, not work days, you need to have been at the White House 90 of those days. So if we're thinking on just a basic work schedule, out of every 10 work days, you need to be there 7. And that's a ridiculous claim or expectation because the White House no longer does press briefings. So they require you to be there to have access, even though they're not giving you access to anything.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that at this point, most of the journalists, at least by Milbank's estimation, who are part of the White House press corps, probably don't qualify for this. But, of course, there are exceptions. And the White House has said that, most of the quote-unquote senior reporters who, regularly cover the White House will be given exceptions. And so a lot of people are still okay because they have these exceptions. But now it's completely this arbitrary control that the White House has over which journalists are allowed to cover it and have access to it. And so we've already seen stories in the past where Trump has blocked, the Washington Post and other outlets from covering his rallies and things like that. Now we have this situation where if you want to cover the White House, you have to, you have to basically appeal to them because they have complete arbitrary control over whether or not you're allowed to keep coming back.
There used to be prestige to being a White House correspondent. But if you're not allowed access, you're essentially a stenographer just repeating whatever Sarah Huckabee Sanders says, or you repeat what the president uttered as your life is being threatened at his rallies. So wouldn't it behoove the White House press staff just not to show up?
I mean, it's a really interesting question at this point. We still get some press availability, which is, we see Trump on the South Lawn before he hops on his helicopter to go somewhere. He usually takes some questions. Of course, it's always hard to hear because there's a helicopter warming up in the background. Sometimes Sarah Huckabee Sanders will go out onto the driveway. And so they have these little availabilities that aren't scheduled. They're impromptu, they're not daily, they're not reliable, but they are still press. And it's hard to say whether that is as valuable because it's not the same format as being in the press briefing room where there's an exchange, where, reporters have a clear opportunity to ask questions and follow up questions. But I think that also speaks to just how contentious everything has been in the relationship that the administration has had with the press, because there was actually a study of Sanders' press briefings while she was still having them. We haven't had one. It's been almost 2 months since the last White House press briefing that found that she took fewer questions and she was much more contentious in exchanges than her predecessors in that position. And so that sort of just speaks to this idea that the White House just doesn't want to have to be accountable to the press, right? We saw this with the whole thing with Jim Acosta from CNN in November when Trump gave one of his very fleetingly rare actual solo press conferences. And Jim Acosta said, hey, remember when CNN got a bunch of bomb threats and then you kept calling us enemy of the people? Do you want to like maybe try to rethink that so that we don't continue to get those kinds of violent threats? And Trump was like, no, 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 you're the enemy of the people. And Acosta tried to press him. And, you know, then there was this doctored video where they tried to make it look like he was knocking the mic out of the aide's hand or knocking her arm, you know, which wasn't what happened. And they revoked his press credential. And it took a federal judge to say, you did not give him due process. You can't just take away his press credential. But then the White House said, well, okay, but then our reporters need to really have more, quote unquote, decorum. So this isn't like the first time that we've seen a crackdown on the press. The White House is always saying, if you want access, you have to be nice to us. You can't ask us challenging questions or push back when we're, you know, lying to you or saying things that are outright terrible.
Well, you're a reporter. Is there news coming out of the White House worthy of a seasoned veteran to cover?
It's hard to say because at this time it feels like the press is often just the pawn of the administration. You know, its opportunity to spew its garbage, whatever its, you know, lie of the day is. And the press just shows up. And as you said, you know, it's not even stenography so much as just capturing it on video and just showing it live or showing it on Twitter or things like that, and you know, not really offering any analysis other than to directly quote it. And it just seems so unworthwhile because there's very little of value in there. It's only news because they said it, not because the content itself is newsworthy. The problem is the idea of orchestrating some sort of boycott or, you know, having all the mainstream outlets, you know, turn away from it is that Trump has given credentials to a whole lot of crazy extreme conservative websites that are happy to shower him with praise. So, you know, even if the Post and the Times and CNN and ABC or, and whoever back away, then you'll still get Breitbart and One American News and Fox covering it. And so there's not really an easy way out. I think what needs to happen, though, is that those of us who are not just there to cater to the president's talking points need to be all the much more vigilant in how we translate what they're saying to our audiences. And it needs to be more than just being the stenographer. It needs to be immediately fact-checking and immediately providing a context for, you know, the misleading or spin claims that we're getting from them.
Which they do to some degree. I mean, the Washington Post follows the lies. There was that headline. He's lied 10,000 times in the Oval Office. The question is, at what point, if he's a liar, what point do you stop repeating the lies as news, reporting and repeating these lies, and dignifying it? Shouldn't your money and time be spent covering the Interior Department and the EPA and the State Department and what's going on in Afghanistan? You know, one of the stories that was written about Sarah Huckabee Sanders cracking down on press access was, you know, there are a lot of cameramen who are going to lose their living because they cover the White House. And when you revoke these press passes, people's livelihoods are at stake. And I read that and thought, boy, it's all for the news media. They love Trump. They love wringing their hands about him and worrying about him, and they're making a fortune. As Les Moonves said, as the chairman of CBS said before raping another actress, he said, Trump is bad for the country, but he's great for our bottom line.
Well, and not only that, but, you know, you run into the same problem, even if you're trying to do it well, of when you tell someone that a lie has been told, if you don't frame it properly, they'll actually retain the lie more than the debunk. And so if that's your headline every time, you know, if you're not immediately framing it as the lie, if you're leading with the misleading statement and then only further down providing some sort of context for it, you're helping them, right?
Yeah.
It's not neutral. It's you're literally helping them. And so we really have to sort of rethink journalism with a much more skeptical eye for what people are saying and how we decide whether or not it's newsworthy.
If the Washington Post has a headline that says Donald Trump has told 10,000 lies since he became president. Now, I'm not making that up, and that number is correct, right?
It's probably low.
Okay. So if he's told 10,000 lies in about 2 years and a couple of months, then when he lies, it's not news. So what he says is a lie. Everything he says is a lie. Therefore, everything he says is not news, should not be dignified. And I just think the media should focus on more important things like mani-pedis. I'm being serious.
I think where I feel the need to push back a little bit is that I worry that what you're advocating actually speaks to normalizing the lying and having less of a significant reaction to the lying than we should. And so there's a part of me that still wants to say, no, no, no. The fact that the president lied is just as big a deal at lie 10,001 as it was at lie 1. But we need to remember why we used to care whether or not the president lied. What is the significance of that, that the person entrusted, you know, as our leader doesn't actually warrant our trust?
Yeah.
So I still think that there's a need to recognize when the quote-unquote leader of the free world says something, what is the significance of what they said? I think we just have to rethink how we frame it and how we present it, that it's not just that he said it, because there are a lot of things that the president, whoever the president is, when he speaks, it's news. But because it's this president, we need to say, okay, and here's why, you know, it's a lie right from the very beginning, as opposed to letting it just be news on its own and then contextualizing it.
Yeah, I want to ask you about Twitter in a second. The president belches every day, and he can't help himself. That's not news. There's no difference between the president's belches and the other stuff that comes out of his mouth. Equally disgusting, equally disturbing, and of no value. Whatever he says is a lie. So I think we've reached a point where the media, the entire press corps, should be focusing on investigating him. And I know I have some listeners who think collusion was a waste of time and Rachel Maddow had a fevered dream. No, no. Investigate this man because he is a mobster. And we have to stop. We have to stop thinking of him as anything other than a mobster. When you call him the leader of the free world, he is not the leader of the free world. Just because that's the title, it doesn't mean he is. He's not leading the free world. Because
I agree with that.
So, you know, we're living with the ghosts of presidents past and projecting their, what, well, none of them are really that great, but whatever decency they had, we're projecting their decency onto him because he's now the president. We just were trained at birth to believe that the president is the leader of the free world. He is not. He is a mobster. And you have to look at the White House the same way you look at a, you know, a hardware store on Second Avenue where there's never any customers, and you go, how is this staying in business? Well, it's a front. The White House now is a front. Sarah Huckabee Sanders doesn't do anything. She doesn't hold press conferences. What's her name?
Kellyanne Conway.
Yes, yes. She sits.
I could just tell by the like spite in your voice.
Well, there was a pause because I was deciding how mean I wanted to get. But she doesn't work. She sits on her phone all day leaking. That's what she does. Nobody's working in there. So let's talk about Twitter.
Ugh, what a terrible place.
Yeah. Now, he is moving the markets on Twitter. The market, let me check. I think the market was down 114 points yesterday based on a tweet on how the tariff negotiations with China were going. He is moving the markets on Twitter, which means somebody knows what his tweet is going to be before he makes it. Be an interesting investigation into who's getting rich off his tweets, because those tweets move markets. So I'd like to know what Larry Kudlow is doing, if he's day trading. Be very curious to think about that. But tell me about Twitter. Why isn't Jack Dorsey removing Donald Trump? He's violating the terms of the service. And what did Twitter say about removing white nationalists and people who spew a lot of white nationalist talking points? What's the danger of Twitter suspending those accounts?
Right. So this was a report out of Vice from a couple of weeks ago that found that, according to some insiders at Twitter, the rule on white nationalism is not applied broadly because it would require taking down several Republican politicians' Twitter profiles. And Twitter does not want to have to do that backlash. But the reality is that there are, you know, Steve King is sort of the most obvious example because he's the most obvious in terms of his support for white nationalism, the congressman from Iowa. But there are plenty of others that would fit that description. And I think it speaks to, you know, Twitter and Facebook and these other social media platforms are private companies. They do have the right to, you know, manage the content that is on them. But they're making a choice to say, we'd rather give voice to certain lawmakers, and including the president, than face the consequences of honestly evaluating what those people are saying, even though they have the power to do it. And so, you know, it's really frustrating to think about because Twitter and Facebook are not democracies. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't rise up and demand that Jack Dorsey or Mark Zuckerberg do anything in particular with their platform. You know, attempts to sort of boycott either is not really useful because they're so integrated into our daily lives and how we communicate with each other and how we process news and things like that. So we're in this rock and a hard place where these platforms are elevating such terrible things, and the president of the United States can crash the stock market by tweeting about things, and there's no check on it. There's no opportunity because Twitter gets to make their own rules and they don't have to apply them uniformly.
Twitter is reporting profits, I think something along the lines of three quarters in a row. For the first time, Twitter is profitable. I think this past year it finally became profitable. So did Twitter create Donald Trump or did Donald Trump create Twitter?
You know, it's hard to say. Obviously, Trump's been on there for a long time, well before he ran for president. So it's certainly a platform that he has made use of and enjoyed for himself. It's always funny to sort of see how Trump's use of Twitter seems to increase. You know, there was this recent fury of retweets that Trump did for just about like every single person that was willing to attack Biden about whether or not the firefighters should support him or not. Mm-hmm. And it was like, oh, did Trump just discover the retweet button? Mm-hmm. You know, and he's been using it more. So it's sort of this.
And who's he been retweeting?
white nationalists, the white nationalists that don't get, you know, policed by Twitter. So it's this shell game where, you know, we might be glad to see Twitter and Facebook banning a couple of big name people, but there are all these other people that they're not banning who continue the echo chamber, even with a few big names gone.
Yeah, Twitter has a responsibility to remove Donald Trump. They should suspend his account.
I don't disagree.
James Woods, what's the story with James Woods' account?
I mean, I don't know which tweet specifically was the violation that triggered his, but James Woods is a nasty person. He spews a lot of anti-LGBTQ stuff, which is what I've seen. He's attacked me personally at times in the past as well. Just really vile and stews up a lot of, you know, everything that we might think of from white nationalism and you know, edgelords from 4chan and things like that. You know, the fact that he was the voice of Hades, I don't know now is a coincidence.
Donald Trump's Twitter account retweeted the guy who doctored that video of Jim Acosta.
Yep.
Right, you're right about that. Well, again, the lesson that I'm taking away from this week is two things. We don't have a constitutional crisis. We have a political crisis.
We have both. We have both. Gosh darn it.
Okay. All right. And we have a Republican Party that has been hijacked by deplorables. For example, tell me about Georgia and then I'll let you go.
Sure. So this is, you know, one of the things I'm glad we occasionally do at Think Progress is lift up tiny little stories from local towns and areas across the country and show what's happening there, because it's easy to sort of forget or gloss over what's happening. And so this was a tiny little town in Georgia called, I guess, Hoshton. And you know, it's only about 2,000 people, almost all white. And they were looking for a new city administrator, so they had a couple different candidates, and one of them was an African-American gentleman from Texas. And the mayor apparently decided that this particular candidate should no longer be in the running, quote, because he is black and the city isn't ready for this. And
What year did she say this?
This was like 2 months ago.
Yeah.
2019.
Hmm.
As folks may know, racial discrimination in employment has been illegal at the federal level for 50 years. It's also illegal under Georgia state law. It's even illegal under Hoshton local law. But this prompted some of the other members of the city council to complain, and they had to set up a situation where the mayor was no longer allowed to be part of the search, and then she sent out mixed statements. First, she said she didn't say it, but then she confirmed that she had apologized for it and says she wouldn't explain how did you apologize for something that you didn't say. But then there was this one city councilman who came to her defense and said, oh, I know what she's talking about, and I don't really hold this against her. And then he proceeded to share his own fairly racist beliefs, which I think it's important to note were tied up into his Christian beliefs. So this is a city councilman by the name of Jim Cleveland, and I'm going to just read verbatim what he said.
You were going to give us the full Cleveland. Okay, go ahead.
I'm not going to do a voice, though, because that would be offensive. I'm a Christian, and my Christian beliefs are you don't do interracial marriage. That's the way I was brought up, and that's the way I believe. I have black friends. I hired black people. But when it comes to all this stuff you see on TV, when you see blacks and whites together, it makes my blood boil, because that's just not the way a Christian is supposed to live.
And does he quote the scriptures? Any specifics?
Not in the comments that he gave. I should say that all of this was reported out by the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. So, you know, with all these newspapers across the country struggling and laying off staffs and being bought out, I want to make sure that they get proper credit for the reporting they did on this. But, you know, here's the situation where the candidate didn't necessarily know about this until it was reported. And he actually backed out of the search for another apparent unfair reason, which was, you know, he lives in Texas, and they said, we want you to come do an in-person interview, but you have to pay for your travel and your room and board up front, and then maybe we'll reimburse you later. Whereas two of the other candidates were local, and one just drove from where else he lives in Georgia. So the guy backed out just for the sole fact that, like, he wasn't paying to come to this dinky Georgia town when none of the other candidates had to do that. But then you also have to wonder, did they not make it easy for him as another reason to keep him out of running because of his race? And there's no way to know that. And, you know, I've talked about this with LGBTQ studies before, but, like, a lot of people don't always know when they're being discriminated against because they don't necessarily tell you to your face. They don't necessarily, like, use that kind of language in front of you. You just don't get the callback. You just don't, you know, get the second interview. You just don't get the offer. And so I think it's really telling that, you know, I don't want to demonize every little small town as just being full of racists, but here was a really clear story where they were doing this. And what struck me, and what was funny, was my coworker read the story totally differently, is I read this mayor as trying in her brain to do the candidate a favor, that, you know, when she said the town's not ready for it, that would then be a negative experience for him. Whereas my coworker read it as it would be a negative experience for the town. And
maybe you're right. Maybe she, as evidenced by the people who came to her defense, maybe she knows how racist the town is. Maybe you're right. I never thought about that.
And so it's this funny sort of thing where she's using racism in her brain to protect somebody from racism. It's sort of weird and backwards when you think about it that way, but it just speaks to how, you know, a person with the best of intentions who says to themselves, I'm not racist, I don't do things like discriminate against people, might then use discrimination as a way to fulfill those supposed values.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's, if you think about it that way, it's an important exercise for determining whether or not you're actually living according to the way you preach.
Yeah. Well, before you go, we've had many conversations about identity politics versus class struggle. One of the things that I'm learning is that people vote against their own self-interests because hatred and bigotry is a powerful force. And there are people in this country who hate blacks, Muslims, Mexicans, Jews, the LGBTQ community more than they want Medicare for All. It's a disease, it's a sickness, and to ignore that, you're not seeing the whole picture.
Well, I would also say that they might not want Medicare for All. They might want Medicare for them, and not for these other groups that they have different feelings about. People who, you know, they believe are getting handouts or things like that because they've convinced themselves that because of this person's different identity, they're not as willing to work hard or they're not as deserving of the same protections that they enjoy or that they don't even recognize that they enjoy. So it might be just a priority thing, but I think there might actually be a direct conflict there too, that they espouse Medicare for All, but they don't see other groups as being part of that all.
Yeah, it's interesting. Thomas Frank is one of my favorite writers, and his book, Listen Liberal, is state of the art, and I recommend it for everybody to read. It'll really turn you off to Harvard-educated technocrats. His book, What's the Matter with Kansas, was written during George W. Bush's presidency, and the takeaway from it was, look how stupid Kansas is. They only care about gay marriage and abortion, so they vote for the Republicans, and the Republicans are ripping them off. They're taking away their jobs and all their government services, but they're promising the end of abortion and no gay marriages. What a bunch of idiots. And our side, by just thinking about class struggle, this is what I'm realizing, we're not seeing the whole picture. You really need to understand. I really need to understand the deep rooted racism, bigotry, homophobia in this country, and it is a force as powerful as wanting to take care of your family. And I think a lot of Bernie people don't understand that a man's hatred for black men sleeping with white women is as powerful an urge and thought as it is to protect your family from jobs being shipped overseas and losing your health insurance.
And it just speaks to, do you care about other people as much as you claim you do? Like, does what you espouse match that claim? And if you're not taking into account how other people's experiences are different, then the answer is no.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that's a whole other facet. To be continued, thank God for Zack Ford. He writes for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. He has several pieces over thinkprogress.org this week that clarifies the pretty spooky stuff that's going on in Washington, D.C. Get a mani-pedi. That's the lesson from today. Can you stand the line, sir?
Absolutely.